actually was gay marriage. That's why I'm no longer a vegan. It's really very simple. But the slippery slope of gay marriage is becoming an omnivore. Because I was a vegan when I met my husband before we were husbands, and he is an omnivore from South Africa, and they eat lots of meat. And he's also a bit of a feeder, where he'll be like eating something. He's like, this is amazing. Why don't you try it? And he would like drop it in my mouth. So I'm no longer a vegan. I think I gained 30 pounds since marriage and all. And yeah, so keep trying, you know, and you work on my husband too. That would be a very nice thing as well, because he will eat anything at all. Hi, my name is Peterson Toscano, and today's presentation will come in three acts. I like to keep nice, simple, and concise. I'm a character actor, so don't be surprised if you can't see me with this thing here, right? That's not fair. I'm a character actor, so don't be surprised if I suddenly become another person on stage. That can be disconcerting when that happens, but I am still me, I'm just an actor. And it will seem that the things that I'm talking about have nothing to do with each other. I will talk about issues that seem so disparate, and hopefully at the end, you will find that like all these things are connected, that they somehow come together magically. It may take you a week or two to actually see that, but I think that that's my goal, that you will see that these worlds that I work in these three different acts are very, very interconnected. So in Act One, I call it Homo Nomo. And here's a strange but true fact about me. I am gay, no surprise, but this was what's strange. For about 17 years of my life, starting at the age of 17, I believed that I could be cured of being gay. In fact, I pretty much made it my number one goal in life to become a fully functioning, masculine-presenting heterosexual. And I spent 17 years and over $30,000 on three continents attempting to de-gay myself. I failed gloriously, for which my husband is very happy. But in the end, I came up with a very clear scientific conclusion that hair can be straightened. Gays, not so much. And I did lots of, like, people will often ask, like, but wait, what did they do? How did they try to fix you? And it is fairly fascinating and terrifying, the various things I did. There were support groups where you would go and talk to other struggling homosexuals and end up finding out where they all found places to hook up. It wasn't always very helpful. There were some exorcisms that I endured. One in New York City got so loud that the New York City police actually had to come and break it up because they thought someone was being murdered. They were just casting out evil spirits. They don't have, you know, that sort of sensitivity training in the police department to understand about demon possession, apparently. But probably the oddest and most extreme thing I did was I traveled to Memphis, Tennessee, and I spent 2 years in a residential program designed to cure me of homosexuality. The place was called Love in Action, but I affectionately call it the Homo Nomo Halfway House. And well, my first play that I wrote is about that experience, this horrible trauma of trying to go straight for Jesus. And it's called Doin' Time in the Homo Nomo Halfway House. And I thought in Act One, I would give you an opportunity to experience the Homo Nomo Halfway House, to spend just a few minutes in these wonderful, bizarre walls to find out how a program like this operates. So everything I'm about to show you actually happened. There's virtually no fiction. You will meet two characters, one named Chad and one named Vlad, because I like to rhyme, I don't know. And you will hear about the program and how it operates and how I spent 2 years of my life. So are you prepared for a mini tour of the Homo Nomo Halfway House?
Yes.
Do I have your consent?
Yes.
It's important. Consent is important. All right. Hi, and welcome to the Homo Nomo Halfway House. My name is Chad, and I will be your tour guide. The Homo Nomo Halfway House is a Christian residential 12-step program that helps men, and women too, we don't discriminate, overcome addictions to homosexuality and compulsive sexual behavior. It is an amazing program, and I thank God they took me in just in time. Now, before we actually begin our tour, I thought I'd tell you a little bit about the program and how it operates. And to assist me with that is one of our newest participants, Vlad. Hey, Vlad, we're ready for ya. Mm-hmm. Vlad is from the former Soviet Republic of Azerbaijan. I never say it right. But it is so exciting what the Lord has done, how he has torn down those horrible iron curtains and those people who for years lived under so much lies and oppression are now free to come to our country and be part of a program like this one. Yeah, thank you, Jesus. So here's Vlad. Hey, Vlad. So Vlad's going to tell you a little bit about the program and how it operates, and I'll add my running commentary as I do. And don't be nervous, Vlad. They seem like a very friendly group tonight.
Hello, my name is Vlad. Like, have been in this Homo Nomo halfway house for 27 days. Here in Homo Nomo halfway house, we have five phases. We do 12 steps, and there are approximately 275 rules. First, I tell you about the phases. When we move from phase to phase, this is called a phase bump. Technically, only the staff is allowed to bump you. Here in Homo Nomo Halfway House, we have many rules. The rules serve as boundaries, because in our former lives, as practicing homosexuals, we had no boundaries. Now, to me, all of the rules are important, of course, but probably the most important rule of all is you must fuck us.
Oh my gosh, what are you talking about?
Well, this is true. You say you must fuck us. You fuck us on the issues, you fuck us on the family, you fuck us.
Oh my gosh, no, silly, we pronounce that word focus. He's still just, you know, getting his English down. And you need to promise me that from now on, that's how you're going to say it. It's focus.
No, but this is what I said. Fuck us. Now I tell you about rules. Here in Homo Nomo Halfway House, you must make your bed every day. You cannot exceed more than 15 minutes per day behind a closed bathroom door. They leave timers in the bathroom so you can keep a proper accounting of your activities. Well, in Homo Nomo Halfway House, you must shave every day. And this includes women, too. Yes, women, you must shave here, you must shave here. But you must not touch the upside-down triangle.
Ew, and highly inappropriate, and we'll talk about it later. And when we shave, we are forbidden to use any aftershave or cologne, and there's a very important reason for that. The sense memory of smell. You see, somebody could be wearing the scent of a former sexual partner, and that could trigger me, just like that. So let me just say, for my safety and yours, could you please stay in the back of the tour if you're wearing Calvin Klein Obsession?
Here in Homo Nomo Halfway House, you cannot go to the movies, surf internet, have mobile phone, or listen to music. Well, they do let us listen to contemporary Christian music. Praise the Lord. Well, in program, you are forbidden to have sexual relations with anyone, including yourself. Well, in Homo Nomo Halfway House, you must report all FI behavior. FI stands for false image, because in our former lives, as practicing homosexuals, we often hid behind masks.
Oh my gosh, that's so true, Vlad. We would plaster over our true God-given personalities with these false image masks. Well, take me for instance, oh my gosh, before I came into this program, I was so effeminate. No, seriously, I was. And they have done wonders on me. I think a lot of it has to do with our weekly football clinics. It's really butched me up. Mm-hmm. Well, there are tons more rules, and I'm sure they'll pop up as we go through our tour. But before we go any further, Vlad, I want to give you positive credit, because throughout your entire presentation, you held your hands to your side and you maintained good eye contact, which is very healthy, masculine behavior. But not for you ladies. It's a little aggressive coming from you. Okay. All right, let's give them a little round of applause, shall we? And see. So the Homo Nomo Halfway House was not a friendly place for women at all. They did have some women come into the program, but they really were interested in saving men. Now, one thing I've determined in my lifetime is that we as human beings, we can do extraordinary things. And sometimes they're extraordinarily stupid things. That was one of them. But you know, sometimes when you're afraid and you're ashamed, you do stupid things. Particularly when you're trying to please other people. And there was a lot of cowardness. And what I was mostly afraid of, well, I was mostly afraid of the possibility that my parents would reject me. That was terrifying to me. But also, I lived in a time in American history when it was very scary to be gay. I think it's still challenging for some people at some times. It's definitely challenging for lots of different people in the LGBTQ community. But then it was particularly scary in my case. I mean, there was a lot of negative stuff about LGBT people. And there was also this weird disease that was affecting gay men, that was killing them, a disease called GRID. You ever heard of GRID before? It's the gay-related immune deficiency, a terminal disease that killed gay men. Well, they later renamed it to HIV/AIDS. You may have heard of that one. But at first, it was known as GRID. And as a kid, it was like terrifying to read the paper and see that there's this disease killing gay men. And people had some pretty ugly things to say about the gay men. And you know, in particular, I was very much, I was a bit of a sissy growing up. And I'm really kind of happy about that now. I'm proud of that fact. Nobody else was very happy about that in my world around me. And I discovered that in the churches I was attending, in the world, I was not seen as a real man. I was seen as this feminized, less than other man, because women were definitely seen as less than in a lot of the worlds that I went in. And I remembered in the churches that I was part of, I desperately wanted to be a missionary. I wanted to share good news. How many of you have ever been on some sort of overseas mission trip? I know the brethren do that sort of thing a lot. I wanted that so badly as a teen, but I was disqualified because of this pesky gay thing in my life. And I began to experience some of the same experiences of the women in these conservative churches that I was in, that they were welcome to attend, to worship, to give money, but to minister, well, that was reserved for just a few people, a few men particularly. And I bumped up against the stained glass ceiling, as I like to call it. And really it was painful, because here I was part of a group, but not part of the group. Like, we're all in the same boat together, but we definitely don't have the same access. And that was painful. And eventually, after 17 years of going through ex-gay madness, I came to my senses and I came out gay. Now, I you know, the coming out experience is different for different people, different cultures. Some people don't even think about coming out in that same way. But often we have this like image of someone comes out, it's like, woohoo, I'm gay, party, all this. Not in my case. To me, it was like finally accepting the reality of a terminal disease. You've got the gay, it's not going away. You're gonna have to learn to live with it. And I was not happy because I didn't know much about what it meant to be gay. I had all this negative information. And so I needed some re-education. And fortunately for me, in Memphis, there was this really cool church that had a lot of LGBTQ people. And the minister there asked me to do something after I came out. He recognized something artistic about me in a good way. And at that time, Judy Shepherd was coming to Memphis. She's the mother of a young man named Matthew Shepherd, who died as a result of a horrible hate crime. And she was coming to speak to the LGBT community, and he asked me if I would write a poem about the LGBT community in Memphis. I said, well, this is complicated. I'm not a poet, really. I'm artistic, whatever. I'm a Yankee from Connecticut. I don't know about Memphis. And I came out about 5 minutes ago. I don't know anything. And he said, how about I do this? How about I give you some names and you interview some people? And it was the smartest thing he could have done, because I met a whole vast array of LGBTQ people that I had never known existed. There were lesbian grandmothers and bisexual baseball players and people of color who were electricians, who were transgender. I mean, all like this whole array of people of faith, people of no faith, all sorts of folks. And it was great, because for every person I met, it dislodged another misconception and lie I had about being queer. And in those days, I, you know, hung out in Memphis with a group of other white gay guys. And I noticed something that really bothered me. The white gay guys that I was with, they didn't have a lot of nice things to say about women. They were very sexist and misogynistic. They didn't have nice things to say about bisexuals at all. They were very dismissive. They were also very racist, and they were very, like, uninhibited about their racism. And they really did not like femi guys or transgender people at all. And I was genuinely perplexed because I spent almost 20 years in really oppressive churches, and I thought, I spent all that time and energy just to come out and be part of a rainbow-clad bullshit same scenario that I've always known. That doesn't make any sense. Surely we can do better than that. So I began to work as a Bible scholar. And I began, this is, and we're now into scene two, which is called Transfigurations. I began to work as a Bible scholar because I had a curious question in my head. Are there people in the Bible who are queer? I mean, people have asked, like, are there gay people in the Bible? But I was like, I'm not just interested in gay or lesbian, but are there people in the Bible who maybe are transgender, who maybe don't, like, conform to traditional gender? Are there people like that in the Bible? And if so, like, who are they? And I was shocked to discover that the most important people in the most important Bible stories are gender non-conforming. It was just a shock to me. And I want to do a scene for you from my play Transfigurations, Transgressing Gender in the Bible. And it's about a very well-known character. This is a character that comes up in Christian and Jewish traditions. This is a character that also appears in the Quran, the character of Joseph, or Yusuf. Joseph of the amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. Have you heard of this? Joseph. Has any of you ever been in the musical, Joseph of the any of, put those hands up again. Very enthusiastic, Joseph. Any of you actually played Joseph? With narrator, anybody play the narrator? It's a very interesting play. Okay, some quick little backstory. Joseph's father is, does anybody know what Joseph's father's name was, Bible time? Jacob, who got renamed to Israel. And Jacob had a twin brother by the name of Esau, all right? Were they identical twins? I see a no. Okay, for those who don't know in the story, they go out of their way to talk about how these are not identical twins. And we know this because Esau, if you had, for those of you who know the Esau story, how would you describe Esau's body, physical presence?
He's just extremely masculine, like super hairy and really big. That's how I recall.
Yeah, big, hairy, like on a scale of 1 to 10, we're talking like an 11 or 12. Like he's like a gorilla of a guy. And he's a real outdoorsman. He's always out hunting and hunting and killing things. And he's very, like, kind of rough and gruff. And I'm not, like, adding stuff to the story. That's in the text. That's how they describe him. While his brother Jacob, complete opposite. Very smooth, didn't have a lot of body hair. It's so funny how intimate some of these Bible stories, like, getting down to, like, their body hair. And I don't think he manscaped. I think it was, like, natural, you know, kind of smooth, you know, Twinkie-like kind of look to him. And he was very sensitive, it said, and he dwelt amongst the tents. They go either way. What do you think that might mean? He dwelt amongst the tents. Yeah, you can talk to me. It's okay. You're allowed. He dwelt. What do you know what Jacob was good at? Anybody know?
He did the
housework with his mother, particularly cooking. Which we think, well, big deal, men cook all the time. Not in the Bible. Men don't cook in the Bible. They may sacrifice burnt offerings, kind of like holy barbecues to God. Now, Jesus, in the New Testament, he did have like a catering service. He did like large-scale outdoor catering. And then there was like a little bit of a fish fry he did post-resurrection. But actually preparing food, men didn't do that, but Jacob did. And, you know, so there are these gender differences between Jacob and Esau. And then Jacob has a bunch of children, and he has this famous one, Joseph, who's different than his brothers. And I discovered in doing the Bible scholarship that there's a mystery about this story that's in the text, that's in the Hebrew, that you can't tell if you're just reading it in English. So I want to do a scene for you from Transfigurations. I want to tell you the story of Joseph. I'm going to include this mystery and then I'll explain it afterwards. And when you tell a story, I think it's very important to decide who gets to tell the story, because it changes how the story sounds. And for this, I'm going to have Uncle Esau tell the story of Joseph. Yeah, I'm Esau. You probably know my brother Jacob, although he went and changed his name to Israel. We're twins, Jacob and me, although you never know it by looking at us. I mean, I'm a real man. I'm big, I'm hairy. I'm always out in the field doing real men's work. Well, my brother, he's as smooth as a woman, very sensitive growing up. He liked to dwell amongst the tents with the women. They're cooking, they're gossiping, they're scheming. He was a real girly boy. And since I was normal, our father Isaac, well, he favored me. Now, don't get me wrong. Although my brother was a girly boy, he liked the women, okay? In fact, he had two wives and slept with both their handmaidens. And from those women, he had a pack of children, daughters, sons, strong, strapping young men, all of them. Well, except for one of his youngest, Joseph. Listen, this kid, he was trouble from the day he was born, always crying, clinging to his mother, not wanting to go out into the field to do real men's work. And then when he got a little bit older, he began to have these dreams, these crazy dreams he told everyone about. Listen, boys are not supposed to dream. Well, one day I pulled my brother aside. I said, listen, you got to do something to this kid. Toughen him up. It's a rough world. They're just going to ride right over him. But does he listen to me? No. Indulges him, gives him everything he wants, including that robe. Now listen, you wouldn't catch me dead in a robe like that. For one, too expensive for my taste, a royal garment, the kind of garment that a king would give to his virgin daughter. Yeah, it was a princess dress. My brother Jacob gave his son Joseph a princess dress. And that kid, he put that dress on. He flitted about the compound like he was some kind of butterfly. And I thought, yeah, this is not going to end well. Sure enough, one day when the boys were out in the field doing real men's work, Jacob sent Joseph to go check on them. And that kid, no sense in his head. He puts on the stupid dress, goes traipsing across the countryside, making fools out of all of us. Well, his brothers, they saw him from a distance. Who could miss him in that getup? And they said, enough of this dreamer. And they rushed him. They threw him to the ground. They beat him black and blue, trying to beat some sense into him. Then they ripped off the stupid dress, tore it to pieces, defiled it in blood. They came back with the bloody garment and a story about how their brother was attacked by a wild beast, and that's all that remained. But later they pulled me aside, they told me what really happened, how they sold their brother to some traders going off to Egypt, sold him as a slave. And I thought, maybe it's all for the best. I mean, listen, I'm a shepherd. I know you got a weak lamb, you just got to take it out. It's just going to bring the rest of them down. And besides, the kid might do okay for himself there in Egypt land, where they go in for the whole girly boy thing. Well, years go by, I didn't give him a second thought. Who's got time to mourn? Then we had that drought, famine. It comes in cycles. You just got to be man enough to ride it out, but not this time. This time was different. It was like the earth was cursed against us year after year. It got so bad, we finally sent the boys to Egypt to get grain. Not to beg, mind you. We beg from no one. And they were brought before some high official in Pharaoh's court, and at first they couldn't tell what it was, a man or a woman with the headdress, the makeup, the flowing robes. Those Egyptians. Turns out it was their very own brother, Joseph. Somehow that girly boy worked his way up through the ranks to become second in command of the whole kingdom. Now this was Joseph's chance to get back at his brothers. An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. You don't let anyone ride over you. But does he? No. Not that girly boy. He goes off weeping like a woman. And then he comes back to try to teach his brothers a lesson. And then he forgives them and he reconciles with them. He gives them food, he gives them shelter. He treats them like he's their sister or their mother, not like any man I've ever seen. And in so doing, that girly boy, my nephew, Joseph, he saved us all. Now, I always end up crying when I read the story of Joseph, or I see the musical, Joseph and the Technicolor Dreamcoat. It's a very moving narrative. It's a beautiful narrative arc about a blended family. There's a father, multiple moms, and there's a lot of tension in this family over inheritance rights. Who gets all the stuff? And traditionally it would go to the eldest son, but there were problems with the eldest son. And so there was a little bit uncertainty of who would get the stuff. And there's all these brothers, and along comes this young boy, the second to the youngest, Joseph, who's favored, who's beautiful. They even use the word to describe him as beautiful. He's favored, he's precocious. And then to make matters worse, at one point, Jacob gives only to Joseph this special garment. Now, if you look in the book of Genesis in an English translation, it will sometimes translate that as a coat of many colors. Or it might say it's a robe with long sleeves or a royal garment. But in most study Bibles, including the NIV study Bible, there'll be a note at the bottom that says the exact meaning of the Hebrew word is unclear. That scholars are uncertain about what this garment was that Jacob gave to Joseph. So, if you're going to do some serious biblical scholarship, you have to ask yourself, well, what's the word in Hebrew? Where else does it appear in the text? That might give us a little light and understanding. The word is a short phrase, ketonet pasim. Jacob gave Joseph a ketonet pasim. And if you look in the book of Genesis, that phrase appears nowhere else. It's just the story of Joseph and his brothers. They give him, he gets the coat, the brothers rip it off, tear it to pieces, covered in blood. So you say, okay, well, the Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament, is big. There are lots of books. There's Deuteronomy, there's Leviticus, all that stuff. Surely, ketonet pasim appears somewhere else. And it does not. Nowhere else in all of these books, except for one other story in 2 Samuel. It's a story of King David. It's actually a story of King David's daughter, Tamar, the princess Tamar. And it's a dreadful story of sexual violence, of rape, and what happens in a family and a nation when people don't take that crime seriously. In the story, David has a very large blended family, again, multiple wives, multiple half-brothers, half-sisters, and at one point, Tamar is tricked by her brother Amnon, lured into his rooms, and there she is raped. And in a sign of mourning, she rents her garment, she tears her clothing. And in the text, it clearly states that she is wearing a ketonet pasim. But then it actually goes on to define it for us. It says, the garment worn by the virgin daughters of the king, a princess dress. Now, I could just imagine a traditional, probably male scholar, looking at the Genesis account, looking at the 2 Samuel account, and concluding, the exact meaning of the Hebrew word is unclear. We have no idea. It could mean anything. I'm sorry, if you have any intellectual integrity, you have to admit that one possible interpretation is that Jacob gave his son a female garment. It doesn't have to be the only interpretation or the definitive one. It doesn't even have to be the one you agree with, but it needs to be on the table because it's in the text. And if we go with that interpretation for a moment, suddenly the story, it takes on a whole new light. When Joseph, you know, his brothers already have issues with him, when they see him in public, wearing the ketonet pasim, they get irrationally violent, and they do violence to him and to the garment. And if it was such a fine-ass piece of clothing that they were all jealous about, they would have figured out a way to ditch their brother, and somebody would have gone home wearing it. But no, they wanted nothing to do with it. There was something transgressive about it. And there was something about their violence that was punitive, like, we're going to teach you a lesson. And the violence I hear about in that story reminds me about violence I hear about today towards gender nonconforming people, particularly transgender people, especially transgender women of color. How many of you have ever heard of or attended an event called the Transgender Day of Remembrance? Raise your hand. Wow, that's good. I'm glad to see that. It's not the only day that transgender people are recognized, but to me it's the most sacred day of the year. It's the day when we say the names of all the people that we know of who had been killed in the past 12 months because they were transgender or gender nonconforming. And the list is always so long. And the violence is so extreme. It's in November every year, around the 20th, usually on the 20th or near the 20th. Put it on your calendar. If you are an ally or in support of LGBT people, it's an important day to show up. It will mean a lot. So Joseph, in this story, experiences that level of violence at the hands of his own brothers. He goes off to Egypt where he is favored by everyone. Everybody loves Joseph, sometimes a little too much. And he gets into some trouble and he lands in prison. But even in the all-male prison population, he rises to the top. He has this ability to interpret dreams. He becomes second in command of the kingdom. Then the brothers come. There's this drought. They need food. They come. They don't recognize him. And he has the power to crush them, and the right to do so. And if he acted like any other man in that family, that's how he probably would have responded to get his revenge. But he doesn't. He does something extremely different. He brings them close. He becomes like the matriarch of the family, bringing them all together. Not that a man can't do that, but in that family and in those stories up until then, we didn't see that modeled. And he did something extraordinarily different. And he sort of transgresses and transcends, goes above what it meant to be a man and expanded that in new directions and even showed a new way of responding to conflict and violence. And I spent a good 5-6 years telling that story and other stories like it because I found it so curious that in the LGBT community, we're all in the same boat together, we're all being oppressed, but some of us were being oppressed by each other. And that to me was extremely problematic. That excerpt of that play is part of a larger play that has just been filmed. I was just out in Oregon and it's becoming a film and it will be out by Christmas time. It's called Transfigurations, Transgressing Gender in the Bible. And there are loads of other very interesting gender nonconforming Bible characters. So that's Act Two. They're dropping like flies. That brings us to Act Three. And of course, the most obvious thing that we talk about at this point is climate change, right? I mean, that makes sense, right? Homo nomo, gender nonconforming characters, climate change. All fits beautifully. And I'm done, right? I mean, I don't have to explain anything else. Let me take a sip of water, maybe. A couple years ago, like 4 years ago, I had a major breakthrough, revelation, freak out moment about climate change. I'm not an environmentalist, I'm not a scientist, I'm this humanities, theater, Bible geek guy. But suddenly I began to read about climate change and I had this epiphany. It was like I was in a sleeper cell and I was like awake, like, oh my gosh, we gotta do something about this. And I also despaired because when people talked about climate change, they always seemed to try to scare the snot out of everybody. And when I say snot, I mean shit. I mean, they really, it was like, be afraid, be very afraid. And then if it wasn't scaring, it was to make people feel really guilty. Like, you're bad consumers, you should be doing nothing, you shouldn't be breathing, you're screwing up this planet. And I'm like, after years of being oppressed by the churches, I have determined that fear and shame are really crappy motivators to get anybody to do anything. And so surely there are other ways. So I took a year off to study climate science and to study ways to communicate climate change. And I began to develop various strategies and stories, even asking odd questions like, what is a queer response to climate change, as in LGBT? How is this a queer issue? And what does this have to do with people of faith? And what's funny about climate change, if anything? And what are stories we can tell? And how do we get people to recognize that they've got skin in the game? So to help me with this, I have a comic alter ego that I can slip into, a character by the name of Marvin Bloom. And we're gonna do the final act as Marvin. Let me fix him up. He has hair, unlike me. It's kind of like having my own little pet on the road here with Marvin. sometimes when I travel and I go like through security, I worry that they're gonna be like, okay, what's going on with all the wigs and who are you? I'm a climate activist, I say. So with Marvin, maybe some of these pieces will come together. Marvin's gonna tell you, break it down a little bit for you. And any questions or comments before we go any further that you need to have answered? Just wanna make sure no one's like distracted by some pressing concern. No? All right. All right, so let me slip into Marvin. And I have no control over Marvin, by the way. Once the wig goes on, I'm gone. Hi, everyone. My name is Marvin Bloom. I'm from Long Island. Can you understand me? Yeah. Yes? Good. Are you, any of you Amish here? There's a lot of Amish around here. Not Amish. Okay. All right, so climate change, right? Lots of talk about climate change, people freaking out. You know, and as a result of all the climate change talks, I don't know if you've noticed, but there's been a huge uptick in polar bear imagery in the world. Have you noticed, like, polar bears just like blew up on the internet? It's like polar bear porn and not the good kind. And no, but these photographers, I have to say, they are amazing. They take these photographs and they tell whole stories. You see this polar bear, it's on an ice floe. It looks so sad. It looks so forlorn. Like, it tugs at your heart. Like, you want to go over and hug it, right? No, you don't want to hug it. It will rip you to shreds, okay? Polar bears are vicious. They're the largest carnivores on land. No, very dangerous. Still, it is very sad that the habitat is shrinking, and as a result, they can't go off and murder seals like they like to do. So now the polar bears are going on land, right? And they're going into landfills and people's backyards into their garbage. Like, polar bears have become the raccoons of Alaska. Okay, they're disgusting. No, actually, I don't like polar bears. They're vicious and they're gross. They're horrible creatures. You know, but the problem is all this, you know, all of this focus on the Arctic, right, and climate change. Well, the climate isn't just changing up in the north. It's also changing in Central America, where there is this disease, this fungus that's spreading like wildfire, attacking coffee plants. It's called coffee leaf rust. It's a real thing. Look it up. Now, this is going to sound awful, right? But I think I could live without polar bears. But a world without coffee? No, that's a dystopian future that I can't face. No, we got to do something about that. So, you know, so I've been thinking, my partner Tristan and I were trying to think about, like, well, how the hell do we respond to climate change? You know, and, you know, he's gay. Well, he's actually trans and he's gay. It's complicated. It's wonderful. But, you know, we've like, well, what are some queer responses to climate change? Because it's a very queer issue. And now if we look at it this way, you know, it's serious, right? But don't freak out. There's still hope, all right? We haven't gone to hell in a handbasket yet, all right? We're not dead in the water. All right, honestly, we can say we know the shit's gonna hit the fan, okay? But we don't know how much shit and how big of a fan we're gonna need to deal with it, all right? So we're working on responses, solutions, and I think there are queer responses to, you know, climate change. So worst case scenario, don't freak out, okay? But the worst case scenario is that we're looking at the potential extinction of the human race. Don't freak out. We're not gonna let that happen. But that's, no, but like for a moment, what other people on the planet have faced potential extinctions and exterminations? Lots of different people, but also queer people. I mean, like, you know, you look at like Nazi Germany, Hitler, he had a hit list, right? He went after my people, the Jews, but he didn't like Jehovah's Witnesses. No idea why. I don't know what happened there, all right? He didn't like people with disabilities, and he didn't like gay people. I mean, God help the Jew for Jesus in a wheelchair who's gay. Like, public enemy number one. It would be awful, right? No, and so the homosexuals were targeted in Nazi Germany as well. And, you know, and even today, we have, you know, an epidemic of violence towards transgender people, especially transgender women of color. And so we've had to develop strategies for addressing this threat. But the best example, I think, that gives me a lot of hope about the climate thing is a time when we faced a potential extermination and extinction way back, like, in the 80s. There was this disease. It was called GRID. Have you ever heard of GRID before? Oh, you have. Most people don't know what it is. It's the gay-related immune deficiency. It was later renamed HIV/AIDS. You know all that, though, I'm sure. But it was horrible. There was a 100% fatality rate. If you had AIDS, you were going to die. No questions asked. And they had a government, it's just like today with climate change, a government that was doing nothing about it. The president at the time, Ronald Reagan, he wouldn't even say the words HIV/AIDS. You had a public, oh my gosh, hostile, afraid, growing more hostile, and all the time people were dying. So we had to act up, well, my ancestors had to lobby the government, change public perception through art and all of that stuff, and had to look after people, learn about medical interventions. It was a rough time. There were hospitals that would not take AIDS patients, funeral homes that would not bury our bodies. It was a very terrible time. But the community came together and responded in this amazing way to look after each other and to change the world. So I think there's some real models for us there with climate change. Now, I have to admit, not everything was perfect during the AIDS years. I mean, everyone with AIDS suffered, okay? But not equally. I mean, some people suffered more or less depending on their access to healthcare, their race, their class, their strata in society. I mean, yes, we were all in the same boat together, just not all on the same deck. And that's what I see with climate change. It doesn't affect everyone equally. Climate change globally affects women more than men, which is weird. It affects people of color more than white people. It affects poor people more than rich people. So basically, climate change is sexist, racist, classist. It sounds very American to me. I don't know, I'm just saying. And so if we're gonna address climate change, we need to not just fix the problem, but we need to think about human rights, social justice, come up with solutions that don't cause more problems, because why should we go to all the trouble to save civilization and everything we care about if we're just going to keep doing the same damn oppression we've been doing for thousands of years? Which, of course, I don't know, when I think about that, I think of the Bible. I think of the story of Joseph. You know the story of Joseph with the technicolor thing? Of this friend Peterson, oh my God, he thinks it's a princess dress, whatever. But there's a very interesting climate connection to the Joseph story. Because Joseph, right, he gets sent off to Egypt. You know the story? Have you heard the story before? Very informed audience. I like that. He's shipped off to Egypt, and he's there, and he, you know, he's very good at interpreting dreams. And turns out the Pharaoh, the king, he's having these weird dreams about cows. I don't know if I never had a cow dream. But he's having these dreams of these seven gorgeous fat cows, and then these seven scary skinny cows. And in the dream, the seven skinny, scary cows eat the fat, gorgeous cows. And Pharaoh wakes up freaking out, like, what does it mean? What does it mean? So he asked all his people to, you know, to figure it out, and they couldn't figure it out. And then somebody said, well, you know, there's a guy in jail. He's good at dreams. Let's ask him. So they haul Joseph up, they clean him up, they bring him before Pharaoh, and he says, well, what's your dream? So Pharaoh tells the dream, the cows and everything. And basically, with that data, you have Joseph analyzing the data, and he predicts climate change. Temporary regional climate change. He basically says there's going to be 7 years of plenty. Everything will grow beautifully. Followed by 7 years, nothing. Nothing will grow, absolute drought, potential famine. Then he comes up with a solution, an adaptation plan, as you like. And he said, what we need to do in those seven very good years, grow as much as possible, save as much as possible, so that when we get to the seven lean years, there's food for the people. And it's wonderful. And it worked. It was a very wonderful, powerful plan that there was food. And in fact, it was during those dry years that he got reunited with his brothers. You know, this whole big drama, whatever. But, you know, they came as climate migrants looking for food to Egypt. It was, you know, whatever. But, you know, and so, but it was wonderful because everyone ate. There is one problem, though, with Joseph's plan. I don't like to pick on biblical characters, but I think there's a flaw in his plan. Because in Egypt at that time, everyone ate, but to get that food from Pharaoh, you had to pay for it. And it was expensive. So the first year, they paid with money. Then they ran out of money. And then Joseph's like, well, we'll take your livestock. You got livestock? Sure. So all the cattle and all that, they took. Then they, you know, still another year of famine. What do you got? And they're like, we have nothing else. And Joseph says, well, you got land. How about you give your land to Pharaoh in exchange for the grain? So they do. Still, there's more years of famine. They're like, now what? And Joseph says, well, what about your children? How about you give your children to serve Pharaoh as servants? As, you know, don't say slaves, but as servants. So they said, well, what are we going to do? We got to eat. So they do. And then still more famine. And then he says, well, what else you got? You know, give your own bodies. How about you all become servants to Pharaoh? So what happens is ultimately Pharaoh becomes the ultimate 1%, leading to oppression, leading to slavery. It's a horrible thing. So as we're looking at solutions to climate change, well, of course, we need to think about ways that we're going to fix the problem without creating more problems. Now, my partner, Tristan, he thinks that we all should become vegans. But, you know, but that's another story. Act one was Homo Nomo. Act two was Transfigurations. Act three, climate queer, I don't know. In conclusion, I've been really thinking a lot about the times that we live in, and that we really do live in very special, extraordinary times. And I guess every generation could say, like, well, our time is special and extraordinary, and I think that's true. And every generation faces things, and particularly groups of people, marginalized groups of people within generations face things. But then every now and then, there's something really big that comes along and affects everybody, like the Great Depression or World War II, where most people are involved in the work of looking after each other and surviving. And we are in a time like that, a strange time in history when we are a generation being called upon to think and to feel and to respond to things that no other generation has ever had to face before. And the thing what I get excited about is we're made of the same stuff as those people. We've got the same DNA. My husband's from South Africa. He was part of the anti-apartheid struggle. And he said a lot of things about that time when they were really, you know, facing a lot of oppression. And he said one thing that always gives me hope. He said, when the artist got involved, that's when we knew we were beginning to win. Because the artist began to translate this experience in ways that other people could not only know the facts, but feel the truth of what was going on. He said the other thing was stunning was there were years and years and years that it seemed like nothing was happening. People were dying. They were on the front lines all the time. Nothing happened. And then suddenly, things happened so quickly, it took their breath away. And that's often how change goes. It seems like we're getting nowhere. No one's responding. Congress won't do anything. And then suddenly there's this will. Something clicks into place. But it isn't just magic. It's because people have been working and building this whole framework. And there is such an important work to do right now to break the collective silence around climate change. Because it is the biggest issue of our day. It affects everything we care about, women's rights. It affects food security, stability, pets, golf. I don't care what you're into. I could explain to you how climate change is going to affect that thing. Climate change is very much a Black Lives Matter issue, and Black Lives Matter is a climate change issue. I mean, there's a queer components. Queer people are affected by climate change disproportionately than straight people. All this weird things that we can talk about in the Q&A. But what I'm excited about is that it's one of those times when we're called upon to be engaged in solutions, engaged in being human and alive in ways that other generations don't have to do. It's like all hands on deck. And we all are in this process of discovering that we have new roles on this new planet. And it doesn't mean we all become environmentalists or scientists. It may be very much in line with the very thing you care about, because whatever you care about is going to be affected by climate change. People often ask me, you know, like, you read a lot about climate change. Are you scared? And honestly, there's scary stuff you hear out there. But that's not the feeling I mostly feel. The feeling I mostly feel is just this weird, weird gratitude that I have the honor to be on the planet right now in this time in history. And every time I walk into a room like this, I kind of get chills because I look at you, and I don't know most of you, but I recognize that many, if not all of you, are going to be historically significant in people's lives and in this struggle. And I don't know who you will become and how you will contribute to this, but you are a generation that will do extraordinary things. And I know about doing extraordinarily stupid things, and I also know that we can do extraordinarily beautiful things. And I'm just really grateful for that opportunity to be in the room with you and to recognize that. So I want to thank you very much for coming out tonight. I want to thank you, Jesse, for having me, David, for bringing me along here and making this happen. And thank you for being such an incredibly excellent audience. Thank you, Elke, for the introduction. And we'll have a Q&A, but thank you very much for showing up. Thank you. Thank you. And if you don't, it's fine, because I'm a Quaker, and we like to sit in silence, so we can just do that thing. Lay you down, okay. I see that hand and then that hand, so we'll go there first. Thank you for saying that. I saw a hand over here.
I just wanted to ask, because you talked about your journey with religion and trying to, all that must have been an experience. How is religion part of your life now? You say it's not as fearful, I guess, because fear tactics didn't work.
Right.
I
love that question, thank you. So the question was, how is religion part of my life today? It obviously was a huge part of my life. When I was, during those homo-nomo years, I would spend 1 to 4 hours a day praying and reading the Bible. And it wasn't just because I wanted to fix myself. I really loved it, and I loved God. I loved talking to God and hanging out with God. And when I came out, I was in a really strange place, because for years I was told, you can't be gay and Christian. You have to choose. So I kept choosing Jesus, and that wasn't working. And even when I came out among certain LGBTQ people, they also felt that it was incompatible. You can't be gay and Christian. I even had one lesbian talk to me, and she said, well, you can't be a gay Christian. That's like being a Jewish Nazi. I said, well, that's a little extreme now here. But I understood how, she felt very hurt by the church. So how could you be part of an institution like that? And for a very short time, I aspired to be an atheist. I was like, I guess I have to be an atheist. And so I'm like, I'm an atheist now. And I was a really crappy atheist, because I kept praying spontaneously and thinking about God. And I was like, well, that sucks. So, and I didn't know how to do it anymore. But I did get to meet some other people who were gay and Christian. And they were people I respected. And I I got to know them, and I respected them. I tried going to some churches that were open and affirming of gays and lesbians, but I felt very strange, because it was that setup, we're all in the pews and there's the preacher here and we sang the same songs, and it re-traumatized me. I felt like PTSD. Even though they were nice and everything, being in the same culture, the same things, it was different. But then I discovered Quakers. It was right after 9/11, the original 9/11, not the anniversaries, but it happened, and I felt I needed community, and I knew of Quakers. And I went to a Quaker meeting, and it was 1 hour of silence, which may seem dreadful to some people, but somehow there was some energy that helped me focus. And it felt like a church for adults, because if anyone wanted to stand up to speak, they could. And I came to the conclusion that I'm gay. That's how I'm wired. I'm also wired for God. I'm existential. Not everybody is, but I really care about what's out there and what does this mean? That's part of who I am. And to lop that part off of me would be like lopping off the gay part of me. Now, I choose to be a Christian. I'm still a Christian, and that's a choice. I don't choose to be gay. I just choose to accept that. I choose to express it through being a Christian and being a Quaker. But choosing to be a person of faith, that's not an option. I am a person of faith. And I think it's important for me to come to the table as a queer person of faith, because that's part of me being authentically me. Any other questions? need for clarification. Yes. Sure. There are loads, like I said. Really, if you want to look at like gender and sexual minorities in the Bible who like kind of transgress gender, it's really important to consider the role of eunuchs. Have you heard of eunuchs before? Like not the computer operating system. That's eunuchs. In the ancient world, there were these folks called eunuchs, and they were castrated males. And this was done in lots of different cultures for lots of different reasons. Sometimes when someone was captured in war, they would remove their testicles, sometimes even remove their penis as a punishment. Or it might be they would enslave them and they didn't want them to be able to have children or to make children. But very often young boys were forced to be eunuchs against their will, and I would imagine some chose to be eunuchs. And so they were castrated, their testicles were removed before puberty. And as a result, they never experienced puberty. They retained high voices. They didn't get the facial hair, the body hair, the muscles that come with testosterone, the prominent brow. They looked and sounded different from the men and women around them. In the ancient world, there were men, women, and eunuchs. This other gender, this third gender, this in-between or outside gender. And they had many, many roles in the ancient world. And even in the Bible, you'll see that they're messengers, they are assassins, they're soldiers, they are advisors. In the book of Esther, I don't know if you've ever read the book of Esther, there are 12 named eunuchs. The book of Esther is where the Jewish festival of Purim comes from. 12 named eunuchs in that story who are absolutely in control of the narrative. Without these eunuchs in the story, the whole thing falls apart, actually. And so it's fascinating to see the different roles these eunuchs have. Jeremiah, at one point, was rescued by an Ethiopian eunuch. And then in the Christian Bible, the very first baptism of the early church was of a character named, we don't know their name, it was just called the Ethiopian eunuch. And this is a very interesting character, and you should, it's in Acts chapter 8. We know more about this one character in the New Testament than anybody else other than Jesus. They just give us all this detail, and this is the first baptism, and we're looking at a character who, if you look at what it says in the story, this is a black, African, surgically altered, gender variant, rich, literate, foreign, civil servant who was a person of faith. That's the first baptism recorded in the early church. Talk about like radical inclusion and diversity. I mean, like, what a powerful message. And so I think that's an extraordinary example. So one place is eunuchs. There are other characters that definitely transgress gender. And if you go to my website, petersontoscano.com, you can sign up for my newsletter, and I'll make an announcement when the film for Transfigurations comes out so that you can kind of see this. And I know that some people want to use it as a study guide. Well, they'll look at the different stories and explore them. And what I like about it is all the stories I tell are positive stories about gender and sexual minorities who are important to the story. And I'm happy about that because I think people need to hear positive good news, especially after years where people were like beat up by the same text. I have time for one more question. Well then, if there are no more questions, I want to thank you very much. I've got loads of stuff on YouTube, including full character costume stuff. I have a podcast called The Citizens Climate Radio. And once again, thank you very, very much for coming. If you have other questions you want to talk to me, I'll be hanging out here. Thank you so much.